The other day, I was taking my Camaro out for a spin when a jerk of a bird pooped on my hood. Now, while that was only mildly annoying, immediately after that, an entire roster of birds, a full attack crew, decided my car was their splat target for today. So, not to be shown up by a bird, I pulled into a nearby car wash. And I got to thinking, what are all these mystery chemicals getting doused on my beloved catfish? Could any of these liquids be bad for my paint? And I chose the most expensive option, the one with that fancy tri-colored foam. Was that worth the cost, or did I just get screwed? Well, I don't like getting screwed, ever. So today, we're going full Bill Nye on car soap. We're gonna see what juice really comes out of those sprayers and figure out if you should just skip the automated car wash completely. You think he can just lure me in with foam, huh? Not today!
Thank you to Skillshare for sponsoring today's video. Skillshare is an online learning community with thousands of inspiring classes for creative and curious people like you. Got an idea for a book but don't know where to start? Check out Storytelling 101 by Daniel Jose Older, where he teaches you the four C's of storytelling. Or maybe you're an artist but don't know how to sell your work. With The Staples of Branding by Jeff Staple, you'll learn to build a brand from purpose to product. It's all curated specifically for learning, meaning there are no ads, so you can stay focused on accomplishing real growth. And for only $14 a month, there's no better time to explore new skills or deepen existing passions. Right now, the first 1,000 people to use the link in the description will get a 1 month free trial of Skillshare. Now, let's get back to B2B.
The car wash biz is a booming. And by booming, I mean $28 billion booming. All in the sake of keeping entropy at bay. Your car, it's got a natural tendency to become dirty. But what does it mean to be dirty? The biggest contributor to getting your car dirty is actually oil. When you're driving around the less than pristine streets of Los Angeles, the grime of the road gets flung up onto your car where dust, pollen, or actual dirt then clings onto it. When you splat a bug, that's bonus oil. When a bird poops on your car, that's got oil in it too, and some other things, which we're gonna get to. But at the end of the day, the reason you need soap to clean your car is because of oil. If we were to zoom into the molecular level, we can see why we need that soap. Water, it's a polar molecule. It has an uneven distribution of electron density. When oxygen and hydrogen bond to form water, they form by covalent bonds with their electrons. And these electrons favor one side of the molecule where oxygen is present, creating a very highly negative area. On the other side, you now have a more positive area due to the protons of the hydrogen atom. And because of this, we now have a polar molecule. You got a positive side and you got a negative side. On the other hand, oil, it doesn't have poles. And because of this, these oil molecules are hard to bond with, like you and your stepdad. Now, if you've ever tried to wash a greasy thumbprint off your car with just water, you know from experience, it doesn't work. But back in the Roman years, some smarty pants figured out that if you took a fatty acid, some sort of animal fat, and you mixed it with an alkaline substance, that's something that has a pH greater than 7, you can make a material that would connect water and oil, a material called soap. Soap molecules are great for bridging water and oil because it shares some qualities of each of them. The alkaline substance in soap gives it a polar head at one end that is hydrophilic, so it bonds to water. On the other end, that fatty acid of soap gives it a long tail of hydrogen and carbon atoms. Those bond with the oil. So when the soap is bound on both sides, it suspends the oil, lifting it off the surface. So I have here a jar that has oil and water in it. And as you can see, these two, they don't mix. And I can shake it, I can try my hardest to get them to bond, but it won't happen. But when I add in a little bit of soap and I shake it and I wait, the mixture doesn't separate. The soap has bound the two together. Okay, great, so now we know how soap works. But when you go to a car wash, there are multiple types of liquids getting sprayed all over your car. There's a pre-soak, there's a shampoo, there's the tri-foam. Are all these just different variations of soap? Well, the car wash we chose to do our testing is a true touchless car wash. It uses high pressure sprayers to help clean your car. Instead of using a physical touch, like a wash mitt, to aid in lifting the oil and dirt away, it uses low and high pH chemicals to dissolve the dirt. Now pH, it's just a measure of how acidic or basic a liquid is. There's a range and it goes from 0 to 14, with 7 being neutral, right dab in the middle. But pH is really a measure of the relative amount of free hydrogen and hydroxyl ions in the solution. There's even an equation for it if you really want to nerd out while you turd out. But for the sake of this video, the pH of soap determines the chemical aggressiveness of its oil lifting potential and which types of yucky stuff it attacks best. So let's start off with the pre-soap. It's like the shower at the pool that nobody uses. Now, depending on which wash you go through will determine the pH level of the pre-soap. Low pH pre-soaks help by removing inorganic materials, things like sand or salt if you live in areas where they salt the roads in the winter. High pH pre-soaks help clean away the organic stuff. That's sap and bugs and greases. They also help neutralize any acid that's left over on your car's paint. Acid, like bird poop. Bird poop contains a chemical called uric acid. The uric acid lowers the pH levels in bird poop down to between 3 to 4.5. That's plenty low for their previous meal to etch your paint. So if a bird poops on your car, you gotta get off of there, get it off. So let's look at the pH of the pre-soak at this car wash. For that, we're gonna sample some of this soap and run a few tests. Science. So I expected this pre-soak to have a relatively high pH, and it did. It makes sense, right? If you live in a city, you're gonna want a high pH pre-soak to help clean off all that city grime and oil that gets accumulated on your car when you're hitting the mean streets of Los Angeles. Now let's get to the soapy part of the wash, the shampoo or detergent. Now there are hundreds, thousands, maybe billions of soaps. So what makes one better or worse or more pricey than the others? What boils down to what are the active ingredients or the cost of developing those active ingredients. Newer car wash soaps contain ingredients that are specifically made to better penetrate under the surface of the dirt, encapsulating it so it's easier to be removed. When talking automated car washes, those types of soaps require less water so they can save in operating costs. The pH of your shampoo is also important depending on the grime level of your ride. See, not all areas in the world have the same type of dirty cars. If you don't live in a city where you get a lot of road grime and the oil variety thrown all over your car, you're not gonna want a soap with a high pH. You want a neutral or low pH soap that lifts and holds soil until it's rinsed off, preparing your car for the next step in the wash, and that is the tri-foam. Now, I don't know the psychology of it, but there is something mesmerizing about watching a car get all sudsy. But we're here for science, so what exactly is that stuff doing? Well, tri-foam acts as either a conditioner or polisher or both, depending on the car wash. The difference between the two is that conditioners help clean the car, while polish contains a certain amount of wax and polishing compound in addition to the cleaner in it. The tri-foam is a neutral to acidic solution, and its end goal is to help prepare the clear coat for waxing. So your car's paint, it's multi-layered. You have your base metal, and then you have a primer, and then you have your base coat, and then finally you got your clear coat. And that clear coat, it's there to protect the paint from the sun and ultraviolet rays. And it makes the color of your base coat look way deeper and more rich. And when, and it's always when, you get any scratches, the thicker clear coat can be buffed out without damaging the paint. So the polisher in this tri-foam, in theory, is doing exactly that, smoothing out the surface of your clear coat. Okay, but what's with the colors? Okay, that's all I wanna know. Are the yellows and blues and reds, are they different chemicals? Are they doing different things? Are they, Jer? No, they are not. Okay, so it seems like I may have been a little bit wrong. When I first started doing research for this episode, a lot of sources told me that the three colors of the foam were the exact same ingredients, same chemical makeup, they were just dyed differently. But when I went to the car wash that we did our experiment at, I noticed that there were three individual jugs over there that had different labels on them. So I went online and I did a little research and pulled up the MSDS, that's the material safety data sheet, for each of those three chemicals. And here's what we found out. The red portion of the foam is the wax portion, and it has detergent in there as well as wax, of course. The blue is another type of shampoo, it's called high foam shampoo, and it has 2-butoxyethanol, sodium alkyl sulfonate, and coconut diethyl amide, and those are used as a foaming and emulsifying agent. Now, the yellow is an alkaline shampoo, and what makes it alkaline is sodium hydroxide, or caustic soda. Now, it will burn you if you just touch it, which is why you should never be a dummy like me and get inside a car wash. So you might be asking yourself, Jared, well, each color obviously is a different formulation, but they all have some form of detergent or surfactant in it. And I'd be like, yeah, that's right. But that's because there are a ton of different types of dirt and oil, and each one of those chemicals is specific for a type of dirt. Now, in my experience, polish needs some sort of physical pressure to be applied. At the heart of it, polish is just really fine sandpaper. It has a small amount of grit in it that roughens up the surface. Now, we're at a touchless car wash, so how can you polish it without touching? So today we're gonna do a little test. I got my catfish here and I have the hood taped off. One side, we're gonna get the pricey wash. Next, we're gonna get the basic wash. And I have a portable microscope here, so along the way, I'm gonna use it to better analyze the paint and see if there's a difference. We're back at the office, got my portable microscope here. So I'm gonna take a look at each section under this microscope and determine if there are any visible differences that we can tell. So right off the bat, just using my eyeballs, there's no difference, okay? They look exactly the same. But you know what? This is a very expensive piece of scientific equipment. So I'm on the expensive side right now, and it's better than before, but there's still a lot of dirt here. So let's go over to the cheap side and look at that. And it looks identical. Bummer expensive car wash. It just took more of my money. Running your car through an automated car wash, at the heart of it, is simply convenient. Sometimes you just need a quick wash. But if I'm being honest, I never actually run my car through one of these. I prefer the good old-fashioned way, getting a couple of your buddies to wash your car down in the parking lot of where you work. Thank you guys so much for watching this episode of B2B. Follow me on Instagram at Jeremiah Burton. Follow us on Donut at Donut Media. But until next week, bye for now. Also, if you heard a fly buzzing around, he's a little shithead. F*** that fly.